Hey, good morning, Shepherd of the Hills, wherever you are, near and far. As Leon said, my name's Amy. I've been with you guys since February, and these are some first. Thank you, B. Appreciate that. Now let me turn it down. Yes. Thanks, Beeman. All right. We're all experiencing some firsts. Not only is this the first time that I get the opportunity to be with you in this way and proclaim the word here at Shepherd of the Hills, this is the first time I've preached to such an empty sanctuary in the middle of a global pandemic. So we're all on new ground here. We're all leaning into this kind of holy weirdness, I called it this morning. But thank you for joining in. And just trust that wherever you are, however you're joining us, I know that we're all disappointed we can't worship in the way that we wanted, but however and wherever we are, trust that everybody's doing their best, and know that we are doing the best here as well. And I also hope and pray that the message I prepared before these circumstances changed and kind of took a turn is still the message that we need to hear. What I have for you today is a message of hope, and I think there's always a good time for that. So that being said, let me also say that I've loved my time here at Shepherd. I've been with you as a pastoral intern since the beginning of February, and I've had an amazing time learning and working alongside this team and the staff, all your leadership. I love this church a lot, so thank you for welcoming me into the life of your community so graciously. And now would probably be an appropriate time to also say hello to all the people from Dripping Springs Presbyterian Church who have promised to watch online. I know I have lots of friends and family there that wanted to be here until circumstances changed. So hello to you, my love to you. I miss you, I love you. Thank you for your love and support. And I remember I have a job to go back to there in a couple months as well. So I've been on staff at DSPC for about 4 years, and I have taken a 5-month leave of absence from my job there, which I love, to do a couple of things. I am pursuing ordination within the Presbyterian Church in PCUSA, and there's a couple of requirements I needed to fulfill and have time and space in my life to do those and do those well. One is the supervised practice of ministry, which I'm so grateful that Leon invited me to do here at Shepherd of the Hills. Another requirement that's required is called a CPE, which is a clinical pastoral education unit. And that's basically pastoral care in a clinical setting. And so to that end, I've been a chaplain extern with Ascension Seton since January, and that program will run through May. And in that role, I've been assigned to Del Seton Medical Center, which is downtown at 15th Street and Red River. So it's the downtown church. And I was placed at Del Seton in part because I told my supervisors I want a really broad base of experience. I want to be put in a hospital setting where I'm going to be challenged. And you know that old adage, be careful what you wish for, because you might get it, right? So I entered this program knowing basically nothing about what it means to be a hospital chaplain. I haven't spent a lot of time in a hospital setting. And I joked with my friends before I started this chaplaincy that the only thing I know about hospitals, or everything I learned about hospitals, I learned by watching Grey's Anatomy. And there was no chaplain character on Grey's Anatomy. You know, Patrick Dempsey's character was nicknamed McDreamy. And then there was a McSteamy, but there was never a McClergy. Weird. I think that would have been good. But I went in completely unprepared and unaware. I like to say I didn't even know what I didn't know. And I'm still not sure I know. Because what I've learned is that it means something different every day. There was a day recently where I was working on a computer kiosk in the hallway outside a patient's room. And I heard from inside the room, I could tell that the nurses were in there performing some sort of treatment. And I could hear these cries of what seemed to be an elderly man all the way out in the hallway. He was obviously in some pain. And I stopped what I was doing to walk in and see if I could be of any help. And I could tell by the reactions on the nurses' faces that what was actually happening wasn't all that bad. It was one of those situations where the patient just needed some comfort. And this is where my skills as a mom kind of superseded my skills as a chaplain, because every mom knows how to distract a child while you rip off the Band-Aid, right? You know how to provide some distraction while you remove the splinter. And so I entered the room and I began talking to this patient who really calmed down immediately, and I distracted him enough for the nurses to finish whatever they needed to do. And after the nurses left, I said, well, is there anything else I can do to help you? And he called me in really close. He said, I really could use some chocolate. reasonable, it seemed to me. But I didn't have any chocolate, and I told him so. And he assured me that his nurse had given him some the day before, and if I could just go find his nurse, she could hook me up with some chocolate. And so I went out in the hallway, and sure enough, the nurse gave me half a Hershey's bar, and I thought, great, I'm going to go back in a hero. I'm going to drop this off and get on with my day. And I went back in, and I showed him the chocolate, and he said, well, unwrap it. And so I did. And he said, well, put it on my tray. And so I did. And he said, well, break it up for me into tiny pieces. And I did. He said, now feed me. I did not. I did not want to feed this man with, frankly, questionable oral hygiene. I didn't want to hand feed him the chocolate. And so I looked at this frail man who was weak in the bed, and I said, oh, surely, sir, surely you can do that for yourself. And he said, for Christ's sake, feed me the chocolate. I thought, compelling argument. So I looked around, I found the box of sterile gloves, and for the next 10 minutes, I sat by this man's bedside, and I listened to his story, and I hand-fed him half a Hershey bar of chocolate, one square at a time, for Christ's sake. And I realized too late that I should have titled this sermon, Everything I Know About God I Learned in the Hospital. Because over the past 2.5 months, I've been in a front row seat for more human suffering and pain than the rest of my life combined. And what I've realized and been made aware of is that sometimes the only thing standing in the way of hope being present in the midst of suffering is my hesitancy to be a part of it. Our lectionary passage today comes from the book of Romans, which is really a letter written by the Apostle Paul to the emerging church of Rome. Paul was writing to a church who he shared no history with, so I can relate to that. He'd never even visited. So in a lot of ways, this letter, kind of like this sermon, is a personal introduction to Paul's theology. And here's how Paul begins chapter 5 of Romans. Our passage is Romans chapter 5, 1 through 5. Therefore, since we are justified by faith, we have peace with God through our Lord Jesus Christ, through whom we have obtained access to this grace in which we stand. And we boast in our hope of sharing the glory of God. And not only that, but we also boast in our sufferings, knowing that suffering produces endurance, and endurance produces character, and character produces hope. And hope does not disappoint us, because God's love has been poured into our hearts through the Holy Spirit that has been given to us. Now, Paul had spent a good bit of time in chapter 4 establishing that God's promise had been realized to us through faith and that we're put into right relationship with God through Jesus Christ. And in chapter 5, Paul's ready to move on and discuss what this means for us. What are the applications? And we're going to focus primarily on the second portion of this passage, on this interesting progression that Paul outlines that connects suffering to a hope that doesn't disappoint us by way of endurance and by way of character. On my third day in the hospital, way back in January, I was so new. I was shadowing a staff chaplain. We'll call him Carlos. Carlos prided himself on being a teacher, and so he let me ask a lot of questions, which was great for me because I was still trying to understand exactly what my job was. And because I'm an Enneagram 3, probably a lot of my questions centered around how success was measured. I said, everybody around us seems to be adding value. They have specific tasks and specific tangible services that they're performing. And it was true. Doctors and nurses and even the environmental services staff all had things that you could see. The job of a chaplain seemed really, really intangible to me, and I was concerned with how I could add value. Would I be a valuable part of the team, or am I just going to be in the way? That was one of my main fears going in. Carlos was really patient with my questions, which, looking back, were probably pretty insulting to a staff chaplain. He listened for a moment, and he said, oh, I know you. You think you're a human doing. Your job here is to learn how to be a human being, which I thought was pretty insulting. So we were off to a great start, he and I. Carlos took me into a patient's room with no background, no preparation. We just knocked and entered, and that was his style. Once we were inside the room, on the other side of the door was this man. He seemed to be in his early 50s. He was wearing nothing but a thin hospital gown and an eye patch. And he received us well. He and Carlos made some small talk. I was uncomfortable, and I stood there awkwardly. The man described in great detail the spider bite that got infected that brought him into the hospital and the extensive detail of his skin graft procedure that he had had the day before to repair the damage that it had done to his leg. I was uncomfortable, and I found like a wall to lean up against on. Members of his medical team entered the room after a few minutes. They wanted to check his wounds. They wanted to change his bandages. And at this point, I was extremely uncomfortable. I wanted to leave. I thought we should give him some privacy. But as I looked to Carlos, it was very clear we were not leaving. He just moved up closer to this man's head so they can continue their conversation. He could be assured of his presence. And for the next 10 or 15 minutes, this patient tried really hard not to scream or curse as the medical team did their really painful work. And meanwhile, I just hugged my wall, and I tried really hard not to scream or curse because it was really, really uncomfortable, and I'm not a doctor or a nurse for really, really good reason. I get really squeamish around anything resembling wound care, and although this patient was obviously the one suffering, I was struggling as well, and I'm embarrassed to admit it now, but I started to get a little dizzy, a little nauseous, just kind of hugged my wall, squeezed my eyes shut, bent my knees, thought through all the things that you're supposed to do, and I just prayed that I would not faint in this patient's room. It'd be so embarrassing. I watched the clock. I eyed the door handle. I never wanted to leave a place so desperately. And all the while, Carlos stood at this patient's bedside, providing a calm and non-anxious presence in the midst of this intense and loud human suffering. After the worst of it was over, Carlos and this patient, his name was Eddie, they resumed their conversation, and we learned that he was street dependent, and without access to medical care, he ignored the spider bite until he just couldn't anymore, and that's when a friend brought him into the emergency room, and he said he almost lost that leg. The damage was so extensive, and he shared with us over the next few minutes about the abuse he suffered as a child, his struggles with addiction, and a bit about his life on the streets. But what he wanted to talk most about was his current spiritual practice. Yeah, you heard me. He had a spiritual practice, and he grabbed his Bible and he talked us through how every day of the new year he had committed to reading a psalm and a proverb that corresponded to the date. And this was January 8th, so he had been reading Psalm 8 and Proverbs 8 on that day before we came in. This man who had suffered great injury, great pain, endured some of the worst that humanity has to offer, was choosing to place his hope in God and trust that God could transform him into a better version of himself. And I would have missed it because I would have been out of that room 30 minutes before. Prior to anything being revealed, all the good stuff came on the other side of the suffering, both his and mine. If it were up to me, I would have missed it. When we finally left the room, I paused out in the hallway just to kind of catch my breath. And actually, I kind of started to cry a little bit as the heaviness of what just happened and the relief of it being over kind of flooded over me. And Carlos walked ahead of me, and then he spun around and he said, and I'll never forget this, he said, "I think God just answered your question. We do stuff here." And I realized I had had it backwards. Del Seaton wasn't going to be any different because I had been there. I was going to be different because I had been there. I was being transformed by this experience. The hope born of suffering is the confidence that God is transforming one's character. This is what Martin Luther King was talking about when he wrote in his essay, Suffering and Faith. "As my sufferings mounted, I soon realized there were two ways I could respond to my situation, either to react with bitterness and seek to transform the suffering into a creative force." And he goes on to say, "Recognizing the necessity for suffering, I've tried to make it a virtue." Friends, suffering is one of the things that binds us together. as human beings. Suffering is inevitable. It's just how life works. As followers of Jesus, we're not protected from pain or loss. Jesus never promised we'd be protected from those things. In fact, quite the opposite. Suffering is inevitable. And yet some of us choose to respond by being angry at God or by abandoning our faith altogether. I know that some of us maybe even recognize that in our own responses to suffering. But all the good stuff is on the other side of the suffering. Love and goodness and beauty and humanity are the reasons we have hope. Suffering is inevitable, but hope is eternal. Now, one of the first steps of getting to the good stuff is we have to name the narrative. I have to name the narrative. I read a book recently by Emily Freeman called The Next Right Thing, and in it she writes a chapter on this concept of naming what we're going through. And she gives an example, which today, in the midst of our current crisis, might not seem relevant, but stick with me. I'm going somewhere, and I think it's important. Because today we're in the midst of this COVID-19 pandemic. It's unprecedented. But just a few years ago, think back with me, we were all following this evolving Ebola crisis in West Africa as it started to affect the rest of the world. And on July 26, 2014, a medical missionary named Nancy Wright Bowl became one of the first Americans to be diagnosed with Ebola. And that name might sound familiar to you because you might remember her story. She was one of the first to survive it. And this book by Emily Freeman tells the story of their interview with a CNN medical correspondent in which Wright Bowl and her husband, they expressed their thanksgiving and their gratitude for the love that they had received, and they shared their story. And at the end, the reporter commented in the interview that it would be very easy for their narrative to be one of traumatization, but it's not a narrative of trauma. It's a narrative of joy. This woman who was diagnosed with a disease that was generally considered to be a death sentence had survived. And theirs was a narrative of joy. Now, neither I nor anyone I know has ever had Ebola. But I know that sometimes our sufferings can feel just as hopeless and just as traumatic. I bet there's a few of us who could say we've survived something like emotional Ebola. I know I have. We've gone through trials and struggles and troubles which could be fatal in one sense or another, either literally or figuratively. And it's important to name those narratives. There's power in our naming. The Wright Bowl story is a beautiful story of faith, but every story has an arc. And so their statement in this interview is a plot point of many, many plot points along that arc. Our story arc can be one of hope, even though each part of the story might have had its share of hopelessness. Our story arc can be one of faith, even though we may have shaken our fists and yelled angrily and asked hard questions of God. Our story arc can be hopeful, even when the people of the story are broken. That's good news. I love this quote by Anne Lamott. She says, "Hope begins in the dark. The stubborn hope that if you just show up and try to do the right things, the dawn will come. You wait and you watch and you work and you don't give up." So maybe today you feel like you're stuck in a hopeless place. Maybe you need to spend a little time in the darkness. I don't want to rush you. But remember, seeds of hope begin by being buried down deep in the ground, sometimes for a really long time. And eventually those seeds break open and take root and can bring forth a narrative of hope. They just haven't lived into the whole story yet. Another thing I've learned from being a chaplain is the importance of reframing what hope looks like. Reframing what hope looks like. After a visit with every patient or family member, we have to chart. This was a surprise to me. But because we're considered part of the patient's care team, we contribute to their electronic chart. And in this way, we document our spiritual assessment of the patient, and there are a variety of boxes that we can check in our assessment, how we observe the patient on a psychosocial and spiritual level. And there's a place to document what we believe the outcome of the visit was, how we helped. And one of those options to check is a box labeled "Helped reframe hope. It's my favorite box. I don't check it very often, but when I can honestly check that particular box, I feel like I've done my job really, really well. Because we shouldn't look at this passage from Romans and what Paul wrote as this linear progression to move through quickly. Suffering, endurance, character, hope. It's not a guaranteed spiritual quick fix recipe. Our prayers aren't always answered in the way that we would like. The prognosis isn't always positive. The treatment isn't always effective. The patient doesn't always survive. Suffering is inevitable. But hope is eternal, and it's important to practice reframing hope so that we know it and we recognize it when we come across it. A lot of my work at the hospital has been on the oncology floor, and because of that, I've had the privilege of working alongside the palliative care team, which palliative care, I had to learn, deals with end-of-life issues. They provide what they call comfort care, which means that suffering and death isn't nearly as bad as it could be. In family care meetings, I've witnessed these doctors and nurses provide such compassion and such empathy. And the truth is, I've learned as much about pastoral counseling from those people as I have my fellow chaplains. One Saturday morning, only an hour into a 24-hour on-call shift, I got a call from a nurse that the family of one of the palliative care patients was requesting a chaplain. And because it was a Saturday, I was the only one there, and so I went. And I found the family of a 24-year-old young woman meeting with a doctor discussing removing her ventilator that was helping her breathe. They were discussing the decision to allow her to just peacefully pass away. And I listened from the hallway, and as the doctor left, I asked him, "Do they need some time?" And he said, "Yeah, I think so. I'm going to come back in about 20 minutes. And honestly, friends, I was relieved. I had received permission from the doctor to not step into that situation right away because I felt helpless. I felt helpless in the face of their palpable grief. And I thought, why, God, why is this happening today? There's half a dozen other people that'll be here on Monday that know this family better, that are better equipped to deal with this situation. Because until recently, this family had held the hope that their daughter might recover. How could I possibly reframe that kind of hope that was lost? I watched for a few seconds as the family huddled together and sobbed, and then I thought, oh my God, for Christ's sake, get in there. And I stepped in, and I asked how I could be of help. And the mother asked that we pray. And so we gathered around her daughter's bed. It was her mother, her father, her older brother, her twin sister. And I honestly don't remember the exact words I prayed. I know they were guided by the Holy Spirit, because how else do you speak into such unspeakable pain? I have no idea what it is to lose a child. And so we prayed to the one who does. And as we closed our prayer, within minutes, she quickly and very peacefully slipped away without intervention or any hard decisions having to be made. It was such a holy moment. It was a sacred experience that changed me forever. And as we stood there, it occurred to me that all of these people had known and loved this person every minute of her short life on earth. And what a privilege and an honor it was for me to stand with them as she left it. And I watched the mom who seemed to be close to my age. And I watched in awe as this mom, who minutes before had been inconsolable, I watched as she suddenly grew peaceful and calm because her hope had been reframed. Her hope for recovery had been replaced by a hope for reunion. Because suffering is inevitable, but hope is eternal. And after that, all in the world I wanted to do is go home and hug my own kids. but I still had like 22 hours left in this 24-hour shift. And so I went back up to the on-call room, and I'd love to say that I journaled or did something very meaningful and productive. I didn't. I searched funny videos because I just needed to laugh. And I came across something amazing that I want to share with you. I came across this great story of a man somewhere in the Northeast, and he had a garden, and it kept getting invaded. Day after day, he would find his vegetables with chunks taken out of them. And so he put up this motion camera, and he found this. Do we have that first video? I mean, look at that. Right in front of the camera. Okay, and we have another one that's equally as cute. Oh. I hope you guys can see this at home. This is the cutest groundhog you've ever seen, munching on some vegetables. And then I think there's one more of the carrot. There we go. Every day, the same place, this guy loves the camera as much as he loves these vegetables. And his name is Chunk, because he would just take a chunk out of these vegetables. I discovered these videos. Okay, hold on. In January, and the more I read, the more I realized these were old videos. These were 2019 videos. Chunk hadn't come out of hibernation yet for 2020. But by this time, I was really heavily invested in Chunk. And so I started following Chunk the Groundhog on Instagram, which I would recommend you do immediately after I finish this sermon. And on February 25th, sure enough, he was back. Let's see him come out of hibernation. Look. Look how dirty his paws and his little nose are. Chunk dug through the darkness and the dirt because he knew of the hope and the light that waited for him on the other side. And then this cool thing happened. Oh. Chunk got a girlfriend. Her name is Nibbles. She's a frequent guest star on the Instagram page as well. Because when you find hope, you want to share it, right? Chunk had this hope and he wanted to share it. And as followers of Christ, that's all the Chunk videos, I'm sorry. You're going to have to go to Instagram later. As followers of Christ, when we find hope for ourselves, we're called to then give hope to others. Find and give hope. The church is uniquely positioned to make that possible. And just in my short time here at Shepherd of the Hills, I've heard several stories of ways that you all have found hope here, that you found support in your time of suffering. You're doing that well. Suffering against all odds leads us to community and bravery and right action, and these things give us hope. One of my personal heroes, Rachel Held Evans, died suddenly and unexpectedly around this time last year at the age of 37. And her husband, Dan, who's now raising their two young children, made this following post last Christmas on social media. He says, in part, "I have glimmers of hope, not hope for the miraculous, but hope for the mundane, hope for community, hope for healing. So many of you have done so much for our family this past year, I can't thank you enough. Your support doesn't lessen the pain, but it spreads it, distributes it, makes it manageable. It doesn't reduce the load, but it adds strength to support it." That's what we're here to do. Provide glimmers of hope in the midst of pain, loss, and even death. Suffering is inevitable, but hope is eternal. And when our hope is in God, it can't be turned to dust and ashes. When our hope is in God, it can't disappoint us. When our hope is in the love of God, it can never be an illusion. God's love is a source of hope for the future and a source of power for the present. God's love poured out into human hearts sustains our hope. Now and forever. Pray with me. We thank you, loving God, that you have given us an enduring hope, one that can't disappoint us. We pray for those who are seeking to reclaim hope in the midst of fear and suffering. Reveal to us not only what you've done, but what you are doing and what you will do to save and redeem your people and indeed all of creation itself. We thank you that you enter into every heart and make us new through our faith in you and your Son, Jesus Christ.